Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
I just found out.
Okay, I've got this.
This is a different month.
Is it too high?
Too much.
Craig doesn't have it.
He switches seats.
It's the same. It's about the same.
How they get rearranged? Does yours have a red dot on it?
That's a
red
something. I had no idea, but that was shorter than mine. The one I had.
Okay, I charged this thing. It had 100% charge when I left the house.
That's a lot.
I can't even get it to come on.
That's why I got rid of it.
Now, I use these things a lot.
No problem. I'll do that.
I think Tori killed it.
Y'all ready?
Linda's not here.
Ladies and gentlemen, before we start the meeting, I'd like to call on Commissioner Paisley to leave us in prayer and the Pledge of Allegiance.
It's my privilege to be here, one, and two, to have this honor of having the prayer. Thank you. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for allowing us to be here, to allowing these commissioners to represent you and the honor that you've bestowed upon us. We pray and hope and feel that we will do what is in the best interest of Alamance County. We thank you for all the blessings that you've bestowed upon us. All these things we ask in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We'd stand and do the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, John.
The Alamance County Board of Commissioners is now in session. We'll go to the agenda. The first item is public comments.
How y'all doing today?
Good, good morning.
Oh, gonna have some bad weather here in a little bit. But I like the cold weather myself. I sweat real bad in the summertime, just because.
We sweat a lot.
I heard that
all year.
You know, I've told you before, I never know what I'm about speak about when I step to the mic, and that was a good one right there. The I wouldn't want y'all's job, no way. All the waters that y'all have to wade through and so forth to see. It's like the last meeting, so many people here, I didn't sign up. I didn't want to lose my seat out here. But it's amazing how people, you know, we Americans, we don't want government knocking on their door, but we want government to knock on other people's doors. Some people, not everybody, some people just mind their business, go on about their business. One of the things that I was so proud of the last commissioners meeting, though, some of the same people that back in 2006 helped bring in the high impact land use and polluting industries ordinance here in Alamance County, they applauded our landfill. That's huge, because when we got that ordinance, it was 2,000 feet, any of the 13 industries in that ordinance. That's 7 years ago, 8 years ago. And I think the county's done a fine job of the people in these different industries doing the best they can to make them look better, provide jobs, everything that we Americans love. A whole lot of people were selling snake oil back then. And that snake oil, boy, there ain't no guarantees with it. And some of the people that sold those snake oils made some claims and so forth, and some people become victims of them. And I would say that the government was doing its best, I hope anyway, that the government was doing its best to figure out that what's being said is the right thing instead of the wrong thing. The ordinance stuff, we found out that it was the wrong thing. The industries in the ordinance, have we had any major bad deals of any of those 13 industries? Or have they been pretty solid?
Pretty solid.
Y'all have to listen to a lot of people. And a lot of people that some people have turned y'all against are just like y'all. Thank you.
Thank you, Tony. Any comments from the commissioners? The agenda, including the consent agenda, are there any items under the consent agenda any of us want to pull? If not, do I have a motion to approve the agenda?
So moved.
Second?
Second. You already got it.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? See, Tori, do we have the...
Tori has to keep us all straight.
Mac, you want to come forward? I guess you're here to receive this proclamation.
Absolutely, and I'd like to bring with me the chairman of the board this year, Cindy
Meyer. Please do.
Good morning.
We have provided with you a copy of a proclamation. This year, the Chamber of Commerce is 100 years old.
Yeah.
We were incorporated in April 1914. And so we've been taking this year to celebrate our 100th year anniversary, and what you have there is a proclamation just recognizing the Chamber for its 100 years of service. And we're asking various public sector partners around the county to do us the honor of reading that, of accepting the proclamation.
Madam Chair and Mac, if you will, I'd like to read this into the record. A proclamation honoring the 100th anniversary of the Alamance County Area Chamber of Commerce, whereas April 14, 2014 marks the 100th anniversary of the Alamance County Area Chamber of Commerce, whose mission is enhancing the welfare of business and promoting and stimulating economic vitality in the Alamance County area for the benefit of its members and the community. And whereas for 100 years, the Alamance County Area Chamber of Commerce has served as a membership-based, volunteer-led, nonprofit community and economic development organization, providing a wealth of resources and support for new and existing businesses, visitors, and tourists, current and relocating residents to the area, and the general public. And whereas for 100 years, the Alamance County Area Chamber of Commerce has offered its members an avenue for networking with other businesses, marketing their services and products, and for remaining informed on issues and trends impacting business. And whereas for 100 years, the Alamance County Area Chamber of Commerce has worked to develop and market the county as a site for new and expanding industries, providing economic opportunities for business and citizens alike. And whereas the Convention and Visitors Bureau promotes economic development through tourism, marketing Alamance County to prospective visitors by celebrating history, nature, competition, and much more. And whereas the Alamance County Area Chamber of Commerce has broadened its mission by providing ongoing business and education partnerships to enhance the workforce and prepare students to be informed and involved leaders in our communities. Now, therefore, be it resolved, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners hereby recognizes and honors the Alamance County Area Chamber of Commerce for their 100 years of service, leadership, and commitment to Alamance County. This third day of March 2014. Madam Chair?
Thank you.
Commissioners, thank you very much. We've enjoyed the partnership of recent years, and look forward to many more to come. And thank you for all your support to the chamber.
Thank you very much.
Do you plan to be here for the next 100 years?
I feel like I've been here 100 years already, but yes.
Thank you again.
If medical technology will allow it, then I'll try to take advantage of it.
Duke Energy, Neighborhood Energy Saver Program presentation. Is it Valencia Rohner?
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you for your time this morning. I'd like to thank you all for allowing us to come forward and talk about our residential neighborhood program that we're going to make available in Alamance County next month. I also want to give special thanks to Tori Fink, who arranged and coordinated for me to be here this morning. The purpose of this presentation is to give you a little bit of information about it, and if you have any questions or if any residents have any questions about the program, we'd be more than happy to answer you. The Duke Energy Residential Neighborhood Program is part of a program that Duke Energy has made available to low-income communities throughout the service territory here in the state of North Carolina as well as South Carolina. The purpose of the program is in how we identify the neighborhoods in advance is to identify and help low-income communities save their energy and help manage their energy costs. We have an energy efficiency program that targets the Duke Energy Carolina's low-income customers, and we are delivered by neighborhood segments throughout, like I said, the state of North Carolina and South Carolina. We provide home energy assessments. We install several energy conservation measures. There's some information in your pack on the specifics of those measures that we install, and we provide energy education to the resident. Now, we identify these neighborhoods by indicating that and understanding that they meet 50% of the criteria of they have incomes that are less than 200% of the federal poverty level. Duke Energy Carolina determines these eligible neighborhoods, as I indicated previously, in advance. Duke Energy Carolina prioritizes neighborhoods and specifies the implementation order. So, as I said earlier, some of the measures specifically that we install are we provide compact fluorescent light bulbs, we provide a water heater wrap, an installation of water pipes. We only do electric water heaters. We don't do gas. We manage the water heater temperature. We try to make sure it's somewhere very close to, if not exactly, at 120 degrees. We have low-flow faucet aerators that we provide up to 3, as well as low-floor shower heads. We provide a wall plate thermometer so they can know what the temperature is in their home, an AC winterization kit, a year supply HVAC filters is for a total of 12, a change of filter calendar so they'll know when to change their filters, and an air infiltration reduction measures like air sealing and weather stripping for their doors. We work with our local community leaders like yourselves, and in this case with the city of Burlington and a few other community partners that we've identified to help build awareness in a particular community, let them know that we're coming, what we're going to be doing, and how it will benefit them. The home improvement process involves our teams of surveyors, also known as energy technicians, that go door-to-door delivering the services. So basically, we keep it very simple. We provide an energy assessment where the energy technician goes into the home and does a cursory overview of places where the resident may be losing energy. They install the measures. They install the light bulbs. They make replacements. They install the weather stripping as well as the weather stripping for the doors as well as the air sealing. And they provide brief energy education, meaning once the measures are installed, they take the time to explain to the resident what has happened and how to optimize the measures that have been installed to help save them energy and money in the future. The residential neighborhood program As you know, Duke Energy and Progress Energy recently merged, and so these are the homes that we have serviced under the residential neighborhood program since last year. So up through recently, we've serviced about 3,414 homes and residential units throughout North Carolina and South Carolina. As it pertains to the city of Burlington and here in Alamance County, we'll be having a kickoff event on Tuesday, April 8th. You all are invited to come. I've provided the details to Ms. Fink. Mayor of Burlington, as well as Councilman Fawcett, have already confirmed their attendance. It's going to take place at the Mako Bigelow Community Center at North Park, and it's from 6 p.m. to 7:30 p.m. We provide free dinner and child care for any of the residents who need to bring their children. The presentation's about, at most, 50 minutes to an hour long, and then the rest of the time, the residents who are in attendance can eat meals and ask questions and get additional information if they so choose. And this is just a couple of pictures of example bar events. As I indicated, the community comms gets information about what the program entails. We serve them a free meal. And this is how our technicians look. So we are identified by wraps of our vehicles, and they're wearing the blue shirts that indicate, and they have a Duke Energy badge, and they are travel together, so they know specifically that it is Duke Energy. and this is an example of some of our technicians at work. So how the residents are made aware of this event, we will send out a letter within a couple of weeks and explaining that we're coming to the area. After that, in another couple of weeks, we send a postcard to remind them, and then at the event that they'll come in, and then the crews also do door hangs to remind them that they're in the area. We typically are in the area about 6 to 8 weeks, but our commitment is to be there as long as necessary to hit as many of the households in the area that need to be done. And that's basically it. We just wanted to make you all aware that we were going to be in the community. What the intent was is to help those in low-income communities manage their costs. We will be back to Burlington, or we'll be back to the Alamance County area, just not Burlington. We do a round robin, so we try to make sure we're hitting as many neighborhoods as possible within the North Carolina and South Carolina area. Are there any questions or need for additional information?
Any questions? Thank you, Ms. Rowe.
All right, thank you for your time and consideration.
Thank you. Today we're going to spotlight one of our departments in the county. We'll have Board of Elections, the director is here.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Excuse me. I have this nice speech prepared here, and excuse me, and I'm going to do that, but I'm going to deviate a little bit and have some audience participation, because I feel like as many department heads and people as we have in this room just right now that help our department, that I want to recognize them and tell you a little bit about what that department does to help us, and then I'll go with my speech, which will take me just a little bit longer, but maybe not so long. I'm going to start with Richard Hill, if you'll raise your hand, stand up or something. Richard, I can't say enough about all his department does for us. He gets our trucks, he delivers our equipment, he maintains our office building. Like I said, they deliver everything that goes out to our polling places. That's one thing that the public doesn't know. I think that people believe that the election fairy comes and delivers all of the equipment and sets up all the things, and the rooms in the facilities are, you know, just that way. But Richard has at least four trucks every election that he uses to get all of our things out. Going through here, David Leonard. David Leonard has served as a precinct official. He has served as a rover. We use his facility sometimes to have our training meetings. He lets his staff help us on election day. Bob Stowbridge in the back, he does our ADA inspections. Every precinct has to be ADA accessible. We have to do a survey on either a change or in a presidential election year. We have to resurvey every single polling place to make sure it's accessible. Bruce, another one I just can't say enough about. Bruce does all of our GIS. Every time there's a legislative redistricting change or a precinct change or a problem with a road, Bruce has the knowledge to go in, and I can't even tell you what he does, but it's a miracle. He's a treasure. Going around. Finance department. And Tom, you don't know what all you're going to have to do. Finance department is there when I go up with my hands in the air saying, I don't have enough money, something's happened, where am I going to get this from? After the election, anywhere from 120 to 600 pay sheets have to be processed. Finance gets in, they work extra, they do everything that they need to do to get us through. HR, another, bless her, I don't have enough workers, never have enough workers for one stop. We'll start workers working and I'll call Sherry. Sherry, wasn't I supposed to do something with these people? Yes. So they're there for us. The sheriff, his people get up on election morning same time as we do, and they deliver all of our absentee lists to the polling places. And then there's our sweet Craig Honeycutt. He gets it all. When I can't get things done, when I need extra things, I go to him, sit down, try to keep him informed of everything that we've got going on, when we're going to have changes, when we're going to have extra needs, and also tell him periodically how much that, you know, the other departments are doing for us, just like I tell you. Our county attorney, Clyde, we pull him in, and I don't need to say more about when we pull him in. And Tori, you know, she helps. She lets me vent with her about where I'm going to find training places, what I'm going to do to put people places. So, and then I'll just recognize John and David, who've served on our board. So, you know, that's just a brief, and, oh, MIS. MIS, you know, Frank's not here, but his department pulls out every laptop computer that we use. They unload everything that's happened to the computer in the past year, such as updates. And you know when you update your computers, how long it takes to update those. And they do that on every laptop. They pull those laptops. They put them in the precinct, the early voting sites. They set the sites up. They do our updates. Anything that has to be done support-wise. Some of their people go in the mornings and in the afternoons to give us extra support, shutting down the early voting sites. So that's, like I said, that's just an example of what we get from the other departments that serve Alamance County. So now I'll get into my little prepared speech and I'll put on my old people glasses. Okay, my name's Kathy Holland and I serve as the director of the Board of Elections. And I've been with the board for 24 years. I hold both a state and national certification. And elections directors are hired and supervised by the executive director of the state and the 5-member state board of elections. The county has a 3-member board, which is also appointed by the state every 2 years. My department consists of 3 permanent full-time staff members and 1 part-time permanent staff member. And the number of our staff has only increased by 1.5 people in the 42-year period that the county began a full-time operation of an elections office in 1972. Our voter registration database, however, has increased by over 50,000 registered voters since that time, and that averages about 12,000 registered voters per decade. Of the 100 counties in North Carolina, Alamance County is now the 19th largest with the voter registration database. We average between 94,000 and 98,000 registered voters. During the early voting period, I hire, train, and supervise between 10 and 90 temporary workers to staff the early voting sites, depending, of course, upon the election. These temporary workers assisted us in voting over 35,000 voters in early voting period in November 2012. This was over half of the 68,000 voters that voted in Alamance County in the presidential election. I hire and train between 120, which is my bare minimum, I have to have those people, and 600 temporary workers to serve in the polling places on election day. These workers receive at least 1 training. Most of the workers receive 2 trainings, and some of the workers receive 3 trainings. And this all takes place within the 2 to 4 weeks before the election. The average voter turnout in the presidential elections is about 70.5%, and the average in even number of years, such as the one we're going to have now with the county commissioner elections, is 41.5%. The county is responsible for maintaining, the County Board of Elections is responsible for maintaining all voter registration records, auditing campaign finance reports, and conducting all the elections within the county. Our voter registration records are managed daily in our office through a statewide election management system designed by the State Board of Elections. We add new voter registrations, change existing registrations, which includes party changes, name changes, address changes. We remove voter records when an individual has been convicted of a felony, has deceased, or moved out of Alamance County. Our database interfaces with the Department of Motor Vehicles, the Social Security Administration, and the U.S. Postal Service. Every year following a federal election, we conduct a list maintenance mailing. This mailing was designed by the General Assembly to attempt to remove voters from the voter registration records when they have moved from our office and haven't notified our office. With the approval of the County Board of Elections Chairman, I am responsible for the maintenance, security, and functionality of the county's $1.5 million voter voting equipment fleet. And I know you're all familiar and have heard bits and pieces about the changes on the horizon in the election community resulting from House Bill 589. Some portions of that bill include the elimination of straight party voting, the elimination of same-day registration at the early voting sites, the elimination of out-of-precinct provisional ballots on election day. We've had a campaign finance increase, which is the first time in a lot of years, from $4,000 contribution level limit to $5,000. And the law says now that that will go up incrementally, sort of like a cost of living increase, so that that will continue to increase. We've had absentee changes, the shortening of early voting period by 1 week, but requiring the counties to maintain the same number of voting hours. This will result in increasing the number of early voting sites that Alamance County has from 3 sites that we have had traditionally to 4 and 5 sites, depending upon the hours that are required for the election. What we have to do is maintain the number of hours that we were open in 2010 for this election. And when 2016 comes, we will have to maintain the hours that we were open in 2012. So we have to do those same number of hours, but the days are condensed. So we are going to have extra sites and longer hours at those extra sites to accompany those voters. Oh, I'm sorry, to accommodate those voters. The requirement for voter identification will begin in 2016, and thus giving us the responsibility between now and 2016 at each election and through media and interaction in the community to educate all the voters of that requirement. In 2018, the General Assembly has made the law that our voting equipment will be decertified. That decertification will cause Alamance County to have to purchase another voting system, which will cost us in the excess of $600,000. Several of the changes will result in a significant budget increases beginning this year. The additional cost of early voting sites will be approximately $25,000 per site, and a large percentage of that cost is temporary staffing, because with the hours where we have had hours maybe from 8 to 5, or at the library it's been maybe 10 to 6, we're going to have to be open, for instance, in the primary at the library in Graham, we're going to be open from 8 in the morning till 7 at night. And, you know, if you have staffers that get there, if the office opens at 8, staffers are going to have to be there at 7:30. If we close at 7, we're potentially going to have lines 7:30, 8, 8 o'clock. So we can't expect workers to work those hours. So we're going to have to divide it up into 2 shifts, which increases my staffing tremendously, or staffing cost. But this cost does not include the initial startup expenditures for the additional sites. To open these sites, we will purchase additional laptops, printers, data connectivity, signage, curbside bells, ballot boxes, etc. Unfortunately, we will not be allowed to purchase additional voting equipment, not because of anything you all have done. It's that the General Assembly is not letting us purchase any more equipment because of the decertification. We will simply redistribute what machines we have allocated for the early voting sites. We'll redistribute those out, so we'll have the big number of sites, but the machines are going to be fewer, so we're still going to have lines, and so you'll get complaints and know that we're going to do everything that we can to try to eliminate the lines as best we can. I'm going to purchase a couple of tablets like you have here that have connectivity that I can put somebody in line, that for the people who are standing in line, and look up their voter registration and make sure that they're registered, because again, we've eliminated, or the General Assembly has eliminated, the same day voter registration. And if there are people in your lines waiting to register to vote, then there's no need for them to stand in line at that point. So that's one way that we're going to try to move the lines along. Some other services other than voting that we provide include our website, which consists of current election information, including historical information, the times that you all have run for office, how many votes you got, statistical information is how many registered voters. Current and past campaign finance reports are listed on the website. So if you're going through your campaigns and you want to know who contributed to you last time and you don't have your information, you can go to my website, pull up your folder. You have a folder all for yourself, and look and see who your contributions, what you spent your money on. Election night returns are on our website, and I learned from a MIS presentation that on election night in 2012, the presidential election, we had over 11,000 hits on our website because of the election. Community education is a big part of my job as well. I try to speak to as many political and civic groups as I can, and they ask me. I try to interact with Elon for their kids. They're doing projects. I go to church meetings, retirement care facilities, schools. I work with the ADA groups. And this is just, I mean, probably not a big thing to y'all, but it means something to us. As a public service, we don't have a voicemail system in our office. Each of you know, when you call our office, you never call and don't get an answer. Somebody answers our phone, and we'll talk to you anytime you call us. So I consider that a public service. Any questions?
I'd like to ask a question. Were there any restrictions on absentee ballot voting?
Any restrictions?
Yeah, out of the legislature.
Well, they changed, you know, if you remember back a couple of years ago, the legislature changed the requirement for signatures on an absentee ballot, and it was moved down to one signature. Now that's been moved back up to two, and of course there are specifications as to the ID requirement, you know, what will be required to do from those, and we'll be publicizing again all of that, trying to help the voters know exactly what to do. And you've got the form, the standard form. You know, you can't just write in anymore. You have to use that standardized form.
I realize that Board of Elections, you do what you're told to do, basically, out of state law.
Sir.
But did the legislature at all consult with the state board on some of the things they were wanting to do as to what their opinion was as a board?
I can't answer that, Mr. Sutton, but I can answer that our local representatives all sat down several times with me and had individual conversations asking what our needs were, and I gave two of them individual instructions on how our voting equipment works. So, you know, I don't know if they talked to the state board. I really hope they did.
Well, more than just on equipment, I'm talking about, you know, the limits that were made, you know, whether or not, you know, straight ballot voting and so forth like that, you know. Of course, I don't know what the state board could say about that, but
And I had conversations with our representatives about that as well. So, you know, I know that they talked to me, and my guess is, and it's just a guess, that if they spoke to me, then most likely they spent some time speaking with the state board.
I know the answer to this because I was on your board for, 15 years roughly, something like that. Tell these folks what time your morning starts and ends on election day?
Well, my morning starts on election day at about 4:30. We get into the office, and my staff nor I, well, I can't say I because I leave and go to polling sites when, you know, more or less just to check and visit and do PR and whatnot. But we stay until, I'm going to say until the results are posted, which is not quite the truth. We stay a couple or 3 hours after the final results are posted because we have responsibilities through the state board after we release to the media and to their website. We have checks and balances that we go through to make sure we have posted the right thing, make sure that the PEVs, like we were discussing the other day, have all read correctly. So, yeah, it's a time, and then we're required to be back the next morning at 8 o'clock. There is no sympathy.
And I know personally that back in the days of paper ballots, you might be there at 2, 3 o'clock counting votes, a.m. I'm talking about, the next morning.
In the past, we have worked over 48 hours without going home. It's a big thing, but, you know, we love it or we wouldn't do it. It's a responsibility. The citizens entrust us with one of their most valuable assets, and that's their vote. So, you know, it's meaningful.
You just touched on purging and so forth. I'm not sure that's the term you use, but explain to this group how often the records are adjusted and so forth of registered voters, and how many registered voters do we have in this county?
We have 97,000 and some, almost 98,000 at this point. It's not called purging anymore. We use a more friendly term. It's called list maintenance, and we do that after every federal election. And what we do is mail out cards to people who have had no contact. That means that they have not voted with our office, they haven't made a change, had no contact with our office in those 2 years since the last list maintenance. And if that happens, we mail them a card giving them the opportunity to say, I want to stay on your records.
I know personally, well, Ms. Holland was brought into the Board of Elections when I was chairman of that board. That was back in 18, no, that's in any event. And I'd just like for us to applaud her on the wonderful job that she's done for all these years, and we just hope and pray you continue serving this county.
Thank you, John. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Kathy.
Mr. Chair, may I do something, please?
Yes, sir.
I want to go backwards for a moment.
Sure.
Ms. Rohner.
Yes, sir.
You know, we take for granted Duke Power. We take for granted all of our utilities. And I just want to say to you, and I'm sure we all think the same thing possibly, we just don't see it. When I'm in Greensboro and I go by the tank farm and see the gas tank, I tell the kids I'm with, those tanks put gas in your car. And then we go up over the bridge there on the loop, and we look over to the left, and Blues Creek steam is just billowing up in the air. Mm-hmm. And I tell them, that's turning your lights on when you go home. And I don't know, maybe I'm just a kid, but when I see that beautiful plume of smoke, to me, I'm not thinking the environment, you know, because not with that plan anyway. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, when I go home tonight, because of what I see right there, my house will be warm, and I'll have lights and so forth and so on, if I pay my bill.
That's important.
Yeah, but I want to say, you know, I appreciate what Duke does. I really do.
Thank you, sir.
I really do. I should have said something while you were there. I apologize.
No, not a problem. It's a pleasure to be of service. I'm also here with my colleague, our senior program manager, who was formerly on the Duke Progress side. So we're coming together and unifying resources to be of service. So this is a commitment that we have had and we will continue to have.
Thanks.
My
Thank
pleasure.
You, Ms. Rohner.
Thank you.
Thank you, Tim. The North Carolina Association of County Commissioners. Who is?
Please, Mr. Smith.
You're out of order, Tony. Please sit down. Who's here, Mr. Manager?
We just have a YouTube video that we will see.
Oh, you're taking care of that?
Yes, sir. This is a video that the County Association has asked that we show at a regular board meeting. It's a very short video, so just kind of an update.
Okay.
got too many things up or something.
Hello, I'm Ray Jeffrey.
Alright, so I'm gonna put this on there this morning. Someone worked more on your ears than it was. Sometimes it just takes me.
Mr. Smith, if I may, sir, while they're doing that?
No, sir. Please.
State support for public school construction has been cut in recent years. That's why the NCACC Board of Directors voted in January to make restoring our full share of lottery proceeds as county's number one legislative priority for this year. We need as much involvement as possible to help us achieve this goal. The legislature will return to Raleigh in May for the 2014 short session, and we must plan for it to be a very quick session. NCACC Government Relations Director Joanna Reese will explain why this issue is so important to them. And Executive Director David Thompson will tell you how you can get involved. Together, we can make a difference. Thank you.
By May 14th may seem far away. It is time to start planning for the 2014 Legislative Short Session. With your help, we achieved a number of our goals last year. But with a truly short session, we need to focus our efforts this year on those issues most critical to counties. The Association's Legislative Goals Committee and Board of Directors each met in January to determine what this more focused agenda would be. Both groups felt strongly that our emphasis this year should be directed towards the county share of lottery proceeds. We are going to ask the legislature to reinstate language in the state statutes to direct 40% of lottery proceeds to school construction. That's how the original law was written, but this section was repealed in 2013. Without this expressed intent in the law, it is possible that future legislatures will not appropriate any lottery funds to counties for school construction needs. We will also ask that the state increase the lottery school construction appropriation over time until it reaches 40%, as we've seen a significant decrease in school construction funding over the past 4 years. While we will continue to monitor legislative activity and address other concerns that may arise, particularly where it concerns our priority goals, our primary focus will be on funds to meet the critical school construction needs facing so many of our counties. We will again count on your help to make our case with your local delegation and to tell your county's story. Our Executive Director, David Thompson, will outline how you can help us achieve your goals.
Your association has developed a reputation of being a great partner with the state to find a solution to complex problems. In the last few years, we worked with state leaders to prevent unfunded mandates to counties and to protect county revenues in the recent tax reform legislation discussions. Your advocacy team works hard to cultivate these strong relationships at the legislature. But I'll let you in on a little secret. Your advocates did not do this alone. We could not have achieved any of these goals without the support of you, our county commissioners, from across North Carolina. You are part of the reason why your advocates are so highly respected at the legislature, and we need your help again. We are asking each county board to meet with its delegation prior to a short session to explain the importance of lottery funds to your county. You will soon receive a packet from us with information that is specific to your county to help you plan this meeting. The best advocacy is for elected county commissioners to speak to their elected House and Senate members. Nobody knows your story better than you. Please plan to attend one of your district meetings in the spring to share with us what you heard from your legislators. The intelligence you gather will help your advocates as they work on your behalf in Raleigh. And mark your calendars now for the 2014 County Assembly Day, which will be held May 28th. This is your chance to hear from state legislative leaders and to lobby your delegates here in Raleigh. This year, we are waiving the early registration fee for county commissioners because we need you here. I hope to see you in Raleigh soon.
And Mr. Chair, also, like we did last year, we have, remember we had a morning breakfast with our legislative delegation. kind of a meeting in the box that was suggested to by the association, and would like to try to schedule that again if the board so chooses.
All right. Folks, let me just make a statement. This is primarily a business meeting for the county commissioners to conduct the business of the county. We provide a time for public comment, and this chair will continue to respect that particular part of our agenda. Sorry, Tom. Next item on the agenda is a proposed offer for Graham Manor property in Woody Drive. Mr. Manager and Mr. Attorney.
You all sorry?
Sure.
Okay.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, sir.
You may recall 2 years ago we placed the Graham Manor property for sale, advertised it for sale. We had nobody interested in it. We have received a proposal from the Peak Resources folks. And Mr. Nunn is here today if you have any questions. Mm-hmm. Tom Nunn. They are currently leasing our facility at 779 Woody Drive. Their proposal is to purchase the property in Graham Manor, 600 North Main Street in Graham, and to purchase the 779 Woody Drive property. The reason they have to purchase both is because in order to transfer the 120 beds, they have to own the property. The proposal is to reconvey the 779 Woody Drive property back to the county at the time the new facility is constructed at 600 North Main Street. It's going to be a $10 million facility, and will generate about $50,000 in taxes for the county every year and $50,000 for the city of Graham. It'll take about 2 years to build this building, and the proposal is to pay $20,000 a month for 20 years, which would be $4.8 million. They would, at the time they build a new facility and move, they would then agree to demolish the building located 779 Woody Drive and reconvey the vacant lot to the county. And I'm coming before you today to get your instructions as to how you'd like to proceed. And then we would, once a formal offer is received, we would advertise it for a negotiated sale and bid. After advertising it, the 10-day period would run where someone could come in and upset that bid for 5%. If there are no upset bids, then of course we'd bring the offer back to the board for the final approval. So I'm before you today to get some instructions on how you'd like to proceed.
Mr. Albright, I'm going to ask you a question. The $4.8 million price being offered, does that include interest, or is interest included in that number?
Well, that's something we would negotiate and bring back an offer to you. Right now it's $20,000 a month for 20 years.
What do we get from Woody Drive? How much do we get a month for Woody Drive?
I think it was plus about $30,000 a month, something like that. Mr. Nunn could probably. $38,000
a month. $38,000 a month?
Yes. And that lease is expiring in about 2 years, is that correct?
The original term is 5 years.
Yeah.
Right. Let me get this straight. Mm-hmm. We own Woody Drive. We own, what, 120 beds there? Is that
yes,
it?
Sir.
Yes.
We own North Church, North Main Street. We're getting $38,000 a month, and this company is making an offer to the county that they take our 6 acres on North Main Street, our 120 beds, and they pay us $20,000 a month. Is there something wrong with that, or am I just losing my mind? Because if that is their offer, it is a total insult to me. And I think it should be to this board and to the county. It's ridiculous.
It's a $4.8 million offer, but the terms of it, you know, we could work those terms out. I'm not sure how you'd want to work it out. But
what's the effective rate? reduce that number.
That hasn't been negotiated yet.
I understand, but if you reduce that number based on $4.8 million and you take out the interest which we otherwise would be earning on the 4.8, what's the effective rate that they're offering? It's not 4.8 million.
It's probably about $4 million.
is it not about 1.8 million? If you take out all the interest over 20 years.
Now, some preliminary numbers run by the finance officer. Put it at 2.99 million, if present value is used. But as I say, these are the terms that we would negotiate and bring back to the board. This is not an offer; it's a proposal. And what I'm asking for is some direction. If you do want to go forward with the transaction, the building over there at 779 Woody Drive is in pretty bad shape. They've had to spend a lot of money on it, and they're going to be gone in a few years. And I don't think they'll be wanting to move back into that. Excuse me, that structure.
There? How much
4.39 acres on Woody Drive, but it's in two tracks.
All right, we own the land.
We own that.
And the building.
And we own the
if
building.
If we bulldoze that building, what's the market value of both those lots put together, well, would you think?
The proposal is they would demolish it. Mm-hmm. And I'm not sure the current value that we have for tax purposes on Woody Drive, which county would get back. Well, this just has it with the building. It's $2.2 million. I'm sorry. I've got the tax value. It's $455,000 for the land. Mm-hmm.
That's what it's worth on the books.
4.39 acres.
Tax value.
On Woody Drive.
Tax value.
That's the tax value. Right.
Beside a hotel on the interstate. I understand what you're saying, but, you got to look at the advantages of the movement. And I would like to see myself plats of the land on Woody, both, and plat full plat on the Graham,
all right.
The old high school, and I will see that to start with. But in theory, I mean, we could bulldoze the building, right, and market the two lots on the interstate. And I would tell you now, and it's my personal opinion, that marketing that land would be a whole lot more fun than marketing that lot where the old high school is.
Yes, sir. And we have a fairway sign that we lease on the Woody Drive property as well. it generates about $9,000 a year.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you. I would like to say to the board, we bought that land up on Main Street for the reason the courts were trying to expand, and they was telling us they had to have more room. So in order to plan for the years to future, we bought that land for the county office buildings in the future. I think it would be a mistake to sell that piece of property. We stole that piece of property at $500,000, the location.
Well, I'm certainly not interested in building a new county office building, I'll assure you.
I'm not either.
Well, I have two more questions.
Yes, sir.
What's it going to cost to demolish the Woody Drive property, or do you have
I have no idea, but their proposal is that they would pay for that.
I understand.
Right.
But that makes their offer a little better. Secondly, that piece of property up on North Main Street, or off North Main Street, is being utilized by the county now. I understand. Right. Where would you move all those people and offices?
We would have to have a study to move them, but we're thinking now, I think Mr. Haygood has worked on that, and there is room at the environmental health offices.
Without moving anybody else around?
That's our preliminary.
We would, if the board's interested in doing something different with the North Main Street property, we would start looking at other county facilities, including buildings on campus over near Human Service Center. Mm-hmm.
And again, I guess our big concern is once this lease is over, if the building is not in good shape, is that we may just own beds and not a facility. And that's where kind of we're at. We're kind of in between. We have a great asset in the beds, and that's the asset and not the building. And that's the concern is if they decide not to, or we can't get anybody to come in and release it at the end of this lease, we'll be stuck with that facility. And there's a lot of work that needs to be done to that Woody Drive site.
But then you would just demolish it, as Mr. Sutton was implying, and sell the land, would you not?
Well, but the biggest thing, I think, is the asset of the 120 beds. And where would that go? Would be, how we would move from that point.
120 beds in a rest home is a diamond in this state. They don't give you any more. And anybody in the business would want our 120 beds. I would have to have a professional appraisal of the land on North Main Street, the land on Woody Drive, and I want somebody who knows to tell me exactly what those 120 beds are worth before we even start any kind of negotiations with this company. Their offer is an insult. I don't care what anybody else says. We're sitting here with two tracts of land, 120 beds, and they want to take one tract of land and all of our beds, and they're going to pay us less than we're getting now. Almost half of what we're getting now out of it. Any more comments?
I think we're unanimous on that.
Yeah, I think so.
And then before we proceed, then, you would like an appraisal on the land on Woody Drive, Graham, and some valuation.
Well, I think we need that, yes.
Okay.
And the beds. Susan, I saw Susan.
Yes, sir.
Can you find out what the beds are worth, Susan? If you could, and if we can't, we'll try to find somebody to tell us how much those beds are worth to people.
Well, they're not making any more, not issuing any more.
That's right.
Okay.
Would you also like us to get an estimate on the cost of tearing down the Woody Drive?
Yes.
Would you like that to be part of your information?
Anything?
One more. In the property on where the high school was, we paid what for it?
$550,000.
How much did we pay to demolish the high school?
$224,460.
All right, so we got $750,000 already in that deal.
It was a two-story ancient structure.
Oh, yeah.
But we can get that information. So just so I'm clear on my instructions, we'll get this information and then go back to Peak Industries.
Oh, bring it to us and let us see what it is,
All right.
Clyde, and then we can make a decision from there. The board in agreement with that?
Yeah.
Yes.
We'll get it to you right away. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Clyde.
Thank you.
Finance officer's report, Tom.
Oh, Matt, one qualifier here. When you get an appraisal, do you get a commercial? Where do you go?
Right here.
Do you get a commercial? Well, I saw him. I thought that was you. I need glasses. Do you get a commercial appraisal or what type of appraisal do you get?
Well, this would be a commercial institutional property.
All right,
that's the way it's done.
Yeah.
Right? More valuable as a commercial property.
Somebody like Rick Gunn or the Jones man who sells a lot of commercial property.
He's the one we contacted about the initial sale of the property, Richard Jones.
Mr. Smith, I really apologize. On the approval of the previous minutes, I did have one item, and I messed up. I should have mentioned that when we were talking about approving the consent agenda. The only change I would make would be my name technically is John Paisley Jr. The minutes reflect just John Paisley, and I would request that be changed. My dad's still living, thank goodness, and doing well, and my son, who's the third, and so forth. So to remove any issue of who's on this board, I would request that we put Junior on the end of John Paisley. And I apologize.
Board approved the amendment to the meetings.
Sure.
Any objections? Tory. Thank you, John.
Thank you, sir.
Morning, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners. Two things this morning. First of all, I spoke with Chairman Smith prior to the beginning of today's meeting, who suggested that we postpone today's budget committee due to the weather. And you want to comment on that?
Yeah, I don't like ice and snow, and I don't know whether we're going to get it, but I don't want to be driving home at 1 o'clock this afternoon and the roads are slippery.
Yeah. Well, you can let driver's ed teacher take it out.
The department heads.
We can have that you reschedule.
And the department heads who were to be involved this morning have been notified, and we can reschedule that. We'll see what happens with the weather tomorrow, and then I'll meet with the county manager and come up with two new dates. You do have before you a revised schedule for the overall budget process. The second thing I wanted to talk about briefly was an update to my report last month concerning I discussed revenue expenditures and fund balance, and today I just want to touch on the county's debt position. because I think it tells a pretty good story. And just to point out some numbers, when we talk about revenues expenses, we're typically talking about what amounts to an income statement if it was a private business. In county government and municipal government, we look a lot at the amount of debt. And if you, as you can see, over the past 5 years, Alamance County has made payments on its debt to the tune of about $30 million. You see at the end of fiscal year 2010, we were at $95 million. That's been paid back down to $65 million. The two categories you see there, the bonds are typically issued and structured over longer terms for very specific purposes. The other debt can be in the form of shorter term notes, individual loans for specific purposes, but typically of a smaller dollar amount and may include an umbrella of items. So in total, you can see there, $95 million down to $65 million. And that's, if you're looking at debt trends, a good trend. Well, how does that compare? Well, this is where we look really, really good. The Local Government Commission compares counties, and you can see we're between 100,000 and 249,000 or 250,000. And they use two measures, and these were measurements that were new to me. Looking at the overall debt obligations that we have compared to our aggregate appraised property valuation. And you can see there, based on our size counties, the low of 0.326 all the way to a high of 2.521. We are at 0.673%, which is on the low side of the average amount. As a matter of fact, it's very near to the low. Well, that's a good thing. The lower we are, the more capacity we have to borrow. Similarly, on per capita, and that's basically taking the debt level and dividing it by the number of citizens in the county, you can see that every county, every person in the county is responsible for $535 in debt. If everybody wrote us a check for $535, we'll be out of debt. Importantly, look how that compares. Low, the number of counties that we have, $197, all the way to a high of over $2,400. So what this reflects is, over the years, the conservative nature that the board has taken has resulted in us being in a particularly good debt position, both from the standpoint of comparing this to property valuations and also to per capita debt levels. How much, though, of that debt are we spending paying back on an annual basis? And you can see there over the past five years, it's averaged around $10 million. Projected, we're not going to do anything between now and June 30th. For this fiscal year, our debt payments will be $10.7 million. So how do we compare that? Is that good or bad? Well, one of the measures we can use is comparing the debt payments to the county revenue and see what percentage that is. The debt revenue percentage that we have, you can see, is well under 10%. Those counties that had were on the high side, their numbers would be closer to 20%. And think about what that is. For every dollar that we have to pay today to service yesterday's debt, that's dollars we don't have that we can spend today. It's just like the national debt. We know the national debt is out of proportion right now. This shows that we are, again, in very good position, 8.5%, when the comfort level would be somewhere, even for this size county, somewhere between 15 and 20%, and I'm certainly not advocating we go there. Where we are is where we need to be. Our rating services, we are rated AA2 by Moody's, AA by Standard & Poor's. The significance of that is that's really the highest rating for a county our size. A lot of it's based on size. So we did have, you may recall, it was about a year ago, Mr. Honeycutt, that we were told that our debt rating was dropped by one of the agencies. What we didn't realize is that we were like AA1 instead of AA2. So we're really about where we expected to be. So all that looks very, very good. The one tie-in to last month's report about the fund balance is those debt payments do have to come out of our general fund. So if the debt rating agencies see our trends and don't like the way, for instance, the fund balance is going, that is a risk. Okay, if we don't have money in the cushion in the fund balance, it could be at risk for making our debt payments. Well, the fact that now our fund balance is going in the right direction again should limit that risk, but it is out there. It's one of the things the Local Government Commission looks at when they approve our debt issues is, okay, how much cushion do we have there to support if things like sales tax revenue or other things decline? So we're in pretty good shape. And then lastly, My favorite spin on statistics. Told you last month that we had gained 14 net new jobs in a 12-month period. Well, December to December came out right after that meeting, and you can see, again, our unemployment rate looks really, really good. 9.3% down to 6.4%. But during that year, our labor force has dropped by over 2,400, and our net new jobs have decreased by 170. So you got to be really careful when you look at those kind of statistics.
What did you say our total bond indebtedness is?
By year end, Tim, it's going to be $46 million.
For the whole thing, all bond indebtedness?
Yeah, not including the... The other debt includes short-term bonds. A good example is the quality school construction bond that we issued for the tech center.
Right.
It was a smaller issue. It was only 10 years, so it is not included in the bond. It's included in the other debt.
Okay. Well, what? And so the total debt, though, is what?
The total debt for the whole county is $65 million right. as of June 30th.
I got three points I'd like to make, starting with the AAA ratings. Number one, if you look at the Treasurer's report that has all these statistics from Raleigh, the AAA ratings are only given to the counties above $250,000.
Larger
people,
one.
Roughly. Okay. So we're right where, I agree with you, where the norm is. I think we're above the norm, frankly, rating-wise. If you look at our bond indebtedness, compare it to Guilford County. Guilford County is only three times our size. Three times the schools, three times the students, three. I mean, it's everything's relative. Their bond indebtedness is $1 billion with a B. $1 billion, and we're at $65 million. That's stunning, frankly. And I don't think it's the fact that we're behind the times. I think we've done what we needed to do when we needed to do it, and we don't overdo things when we do things, in my opinion. And Guilford County, they just never did what they should have done when they should have done it, and now they're in one heck of a hole. They're having a hard time paying their interest on their debt. Now, like in the United States, if you look at the category of our per capita bond indebtedness, in that same report, there's, I think, 24 counties that's in that range of population from 100 to 249, roughly 24 counties, if I'm not mistaken.
I actually have that, but go ahead and I'll count.
It might be 21, but it's over 20. And we're next, there's only two counties below us with a per capita rating as far as, in other words, there's 24 and there's two below us, three, that means there's 21 ahead of us. How many is it, 21 or 24?
21 including us.
All right, 21. I knew it was one of the two figures.
Yep.
So there's 18 above us that have a higher per capita. In other words, we're third from the bottom, and that's excellent. And as far as the bond indebtedness, when I looked at that report last, there was one county that absolutely had no bond indebtedness to speak of. Okay, and I was proud of where we were. And I called, I think it was Wayne County or somewhere on the Eastern County, and I called their county manager. This is a true story, and I said, how in the world can you have no bond indebtedness, basically to speak of? He said, well, we've got a fund balance of roughly 80-some million dollars. And I kept looking at the sheet, and all of a sudden, I realized their tax rate probably was 50% higher than it ought to be. And I said, how did you get the fund balance that high? And also no bond indebtedness. What the simple answer is, in my opinion, they're overtaxing their people. And I told him, I said, your tax rate, I said, just guy talking to guy or county, men talking to each other here on this issue, I said, the truth is, in my opinion, your tax rate's about 50% too high. You know what he told me?
What?
He said, don't come down here and tell anybody. That's exactly what he said. But we're in great shape, I think.
Yeah, the three counties that are actually better on that measure than we are.
What was one? Was it Wayne?
It's Brunswick, Wayne, and...
Yeah, Wayne County.
And Robinson.
Yeah. So,
any other questions?
Good numbers.
Thank you, Tom.
Thank you. Where is Wayne? Is that on the east?
Goldsboro.
Okay. Anything thank else,
you.
Tom?
No, thank you.
I'd like to make, let's see, are we down? Well, let me just say on the matter of our financial position, I agree with Tim that it looks like we're in real good shape. I would also, at this point, like to take the opportunity to congratulate Tim and Bill, who have been on this board almost 20 years, both of them, and they certainly should be congratulated on keeping the finances of this county in good shape. I'm very impressed with those numbers, by the way. Manager's report, Mr. Manager?
Just a couple of things. One is we will be getting you out a couple of dates for that meeting in a box for our legislative delegation. We'll try to do that as a breakfast meeting, and we'll get with our delegation today. So we'll try to give you a few dates from that. The other thing I did want to give you an update on is in your agenda packet is a very quick overview from Allen Williams, Carmen and King, looking at the Swepsonville site as a potential site for a training center. And as you can see, it's just not really conducive to the site. One of the first questions that the consultant asked was what was in a 2-mile area. Well, one was an elementary school and one was 2,000 residents. So at that point, and I sat down and the sheriff and I talked, and we felt like it was not worth spending the money to move forward with the process and trying to evaluate a site that just would not be in our best interest at this time. So if we wanted to bring that back to the board to make sure that you're okay with our recommendation. And you know, at this point, if the board has no objections, we're kind of putting this as on hold and not doing anything with a proposed training unit as well. And I do want to say publicly, and again, I want to make sure the board's okay with this, is we've had contact from a lot of landowners who were interested in either leasing or selling the county property that they thought would be a good site. What I've told the landowners is we're not interested in buying property or leasing property because, number one, we don't have the funds to do that, but number two, we were looking only at sites that we had control over. And so we're just kind of saying thanks, but no thanks to those people who are making those inquiries.
Have you thought about Cedar Rock Park?
No, sir.
Maybe something to think about.
Okay. We can do a preliminary look at that.
Any objections to the manager's actions on this matter from the board?
We'd like to say one thing. I understand that we didn't spend the $15,000 either.
No, sir.
And I want to commend you for taking that action before the money was paid.
Right. We may be less than $1,000 for the little bit of time that was put into it, but we have, you know, that's one of the reasons we stopped it as soon as we've had information that was not in the community's best interest, but also not in the site's best interest. So,
thank you for doing that.
Oh, not that I'm pushing the other, you know, the landfill that we're talking about, but you know, I didn't think about it just 1 minute ago. You know, when you mentioned that they were talking about how close that was to a school, 2 miles, mm-hmm. just came to me. The city of Burlington, now they still shoot over there, because I hear, because I live near. You could hit a golf ball and be a bad golfer from where Burlington shoots all day long, a lot of times, to the back of Andrews Elementary School. So I don't buy that argument at all. Not unless Burlington's screwing up. Did everybody get a copy of this sheet that you did from here? Okay, they need to see it if you don't mind. I asked Brian to get in touch with somebody that could give us some information on landfills that are closed and what they do with them. Because I'm interested in if it's not for the range or whatever, you know, we, you know, can't sit on that land for
ever,
forever. I mean, obviously, something's got to happen someday. Closed landfill information. It said there was 94 North Carolina counties that have at least one closed landfill. And he lists what we do with ours: model airplane club, hunting dog training, communications tower. I just had a question, though, about one of them especially. Buncombe County driving range. Now, is that golf or is that cars? Cars. Okay. Have we been to that one? Have we been to that one?
I saw it probably 10 years ago.
Okay. Is it, what's it like?
It's a nice, they have a large pad that they do their defensive driving, chasing, backing, and all that stuff.
Is that close sight smaller or larger than ours, or do you know?
What do you mean, larger?
We got 300 some acres.
Oh, no, here. I don't know what acreage is. All I know is the pad, the driving pad.
Right, I'd like to know what the acreage is of Buncombe County, if you don't mind. McDowell County firing range. They don't have schools in McDowell County, probably. I'm sorry, I'm just on a, I've had too much coffee today. Jackson County greenhouse. Cleveland County pistol range in conjunction with NC Wildlife. Maybe they don't have schools near that one. And Cherokee County pistol range, garden for jail prisoners, pond for wreck fishing. Wake County hiking trails, and so forth and so on. So, it's interesting information. And if you could get a copy of the rest of the board members, sure. And then get me the acreage on Buncombe County, I appreciate it.
Sure. I'd like to know where the 2-year requirement came from. A 2-mile, I'm sorry, 2-mile requirement.
It was just a general, you know, a general overview. It's where they start. And I think Alexander Wilson was within a mile.
Is that a federal, state?
I think it's just a general look is what they looked at.
It's a thought.
Not a law, right?
It's not a law, no, sir. And again, the consultant did say that there are ways to make it safe, you know, baffling and all these issues, you know, but the cost would greatly increase for those safety precautions. Of
well,
the site.
They allow hunting, and particularly dove season, for example, and nobody tries to baffle that noise, or and that's certainly within 2 miles of right. A number of schools.
The pellets are hitting the roof.
Any other comments? Anything else, Mr. Manning?
No, sir.
Commissioners have any other comments? Hearing none, do I hear a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
All in favor?
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioner's website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.